Well, it's good to see all of you. Let's go ahead and get started this morning. Let's start with prayer. Our Heavenly Father, it is a privilege indeed that we forget so many times to be able to come into your presence, to come boldly because of the work of our Lord Jesus Christ. And so we come now this morning asking that you would help us to explore deeper yet the whole idea of the already, not yet, and how it impacts our church, both in ministry and fellowship. And we pray that you would cause your word to find root in our hearts as we think on these texts throughout the week, and then conform us in your mercy to the image of your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, in whose name we pray. Amen.
Bob, I'll have you know that in my kindergarten lesson plan for tomorrow, in big bold letters, to explain something to them is already and not yet.
Really? Very cool. I like that. Well, I was walking in this morning. I thought, I wonder if anybody else, in relation to last week's sermon, got new creation, already not yet. Was it last week's sermon or the week before that I'm thinking of, where he's on the Sea of, he's on the beach?
Last week.
That was last week. Okay. How many of you here had thoughts after that sermon and related your thoughts to the new creation and let your imaginations, your sanctified imaginations, run away with you a little bit, what your life might be like then and there? I see one head nodding. I see two heads nodding. Do I see three? What's that?
I see that hand.
Every head bowed. Are there any thoughts that you would like to share that you had? Anybody? They're personal impressions, but I think they're helpful for us to hear how our brothers and sisters in Christ receive the word and then let that word dwell in them richly.
I think I was thinking of a juxtaposition that it's, there are going to be things that are going to seem very familiar and we'll know it and understand it right away. We experience a little bit of it now, but there are also things that will be beyond our comprehension.
Yes.
It will be both.
Yes.
We will, eating grilled fish,
yeah,
and it's good.
Yeah.
It's such a common, ordinary, I love the word ordinary, thing.
I love it. That's exactly right. What else? Anything else? It doesn't have to be already not yet, but Rick, please.
I was starting to read the book and just wondering how this kind of domino affects out to everything else.
Yes.
And it's really kind of a new way of, a new old way of looking at things and realizing how the implications of it will just keep rippling outward.
Boy, that is so true. And if you've been here for any number of years through the ministry of the Word, which we're going to talk about today as really the centerpiece of our worship, it is. So everything leading up to that event where Jeff stands and preaches the Word is that's the whole ball of wax right there, for me anyway. And I'm happy to be challenged in that, but I think that's the centerpiece of our worship. So, what else? Any other impressions about that text last week that you heard Jeff say? There was one there where he said, he's not a ghost. When he walked on the sand, he left footprints. Did you remember that? Anybody else? Did that resonate with you? Okay, well, I'll let you off the hook. It did with me. So last week I meant to read something from this book, New Testament Theology by G.B. Caird. And he's unique because N.T. Wright and Greg Beale both sat under him, I believe. So he was their professor. So if you want a good book, get G.B. Caird's New Testament Theology. He's an excellent writer. Excellent. But he has this picking up on riches. I'm going to read this little paragraph. I meant to read it last week, but time got away from us. Likewise, John, speaking in Revelation, depicts the human future not as a loose collection of individual souls, but as a vibrant, functioning society. He ends his work with a double climax, and it is one of the peculiarities of his prophecy, that its principal eschatological symbols, the courtroom scene, the wedding scene, and the battles, have a double fulfillment. First within history before the millennium, and then beyond history in the new heavens and new earth. At first reading, we may receive the impression that while the millennium is the vindication of God's purposes within history, the new heavens and new earth are discontinuous with the old ones, which have been rolled up like a scroll. But this is to take the imagery too literalistically. For we are told that into the new Jerusalem shall be brought the wealth and splendor of the nations, though nothing unclean may enter it. And he's referring there to Revelation 21, verses 26 and 27. That's a real important point. So the nations in Revelation 21, 26 and 27 are going to bring their wealth into the new Jerusalem, the not yet part. Not only are the gates of that city open on all sides to receive the numberless company of its citizens, you and I, but everything of real worth in the old heavens and the old earth, including the human achievements of inventive, artistic, and intellectual prowess, we find a place in the eternal order. You get the image that he's creating here? So, whatever you're storing up in this age, this present evil age, but yet as citizens of the new creation, those things that are praiseworthy are going to follow us into the new heavens and new earth. So feel free to spend yourselves, your energies, and I'm speaking to myself as well, on all that is truly spiritual and good. So when Susan needs Sunday school teachers or needs nursery workers, or we have, you know, an event where we're all coming for fellowship and food is required, do your best. Do your best for the Lord. The Lord knows our hearts. And the kinds of things that we store up, our treasures in heaven, will follow us into the new creation. I think of Ron the other day. This man's over 70, aren't you? He is. I drove up for Bible study and all the bushes were cut out. And one man did it. This man. Well, did he do it for his own glory? I know Ron enough to know that he did not. So that's the sort of thing that we should be as indiscriminate about and just do it to the Lord's glory. Okay? But I thought that was a great quote and kind of goes to riches and thing that he mentioned. And let's see, one other thing before we get into the book. I'm not going to have enough time today.
You need a Sunday school teacher for next Sunday.
You do?
Yeah, help you. So, your title's taken out of the week.
I told him, I said, I am getting too old for this. When I was younger and I was going through all this stuff and I was a new elder here, I was in my 30s, I would spend hours reading, laboring, thinking about, meditating upon, just spent myself silly. And now I'm almost 70 and I'm tired. I open a book, I read one page and it's terrible. Is that Rich is guilty too? Anybody else here?
You mean it gets
worse? What's that?
You mean it gets worse?
It gets worse.
It gets worse.
That's why I'm only partway through the book.
Well, that's why let this mind be in you, which was also in Christ Jesus. The idea of the Word of God that's preached on Sundays, on Wednesdays, let it just dwell in you. You should be mulling it over constantly. I know I do, and I enjoy every minute of that. Greg Beale, who inspired these two guys that wrote the book, Greg Beale, and he actually has a part in here from last week. He says, we become what we worship. That's what this book is. So if you want more reading, you need more sleeping time. Anybody read this book? Ron's read it.
There's this principle that the things that you read right before you drift off to sleep are the things that your mind is focused on while you're sleeping and dreaming.
I like
so
that.
You need to get more out of it that way.
That'd be great. That'd be wonderful.
If you could only remember it.
If I could.
That applies to what you're going to teach. That would be great.
Well, the event of worship is the one thing we're going to focus on this week. We're skipping over the chapter on leading God's flock in the end time, already not yet, ministry. We're going to skip those three chapters. They're good. Matt wrote Feeding the Flock. Ben wrote Guarding the Flock and Guiding the Flock. But for all practical purposes, your session, your pastor, they could have wrote these chapters. Okay, so you can read those. You'll be edified by them. So let's see. Where do I want to go next? As I did last week, how many of you went home and listened to He Is Worthy on your own? Just one? That song, I never tire of hearing that song. So I have a new song today. It's in your handout. Now, this song actually goes to a part of worship that we want to talk about today, and it's that last word in the title of his song, The Journey. And how many of you know this song? I can hardly believe it. Just two? Wow. I love Michael Card. I have all of his albums on my phone. So let's listen to this, and we may dialogue about it. We may not. I'm not sure. Let's see how it goes here. Yeah, it was beautiful, wasn't it? I agree. Let's see if we can't find the right song. I thought I had it up, but I did not. Let's see here. Library. We'll get it. Won't take but a second. Okay, here we go. My apologies.
For all who believe, hope for the
So when you go home, make sure you find that song. You can get it on YouTube. It won't cost you a penny. But if you want the album, you can buy the album. It's terrific. So what jumped out at you in relation to the already not yet?
Eternity stranded in time.
Born to eternity stranded in time. That's us. Living in the ages, between the ages, the tension of the ages. The tension I personally feel sometimes when there's an event at the fellowship of our brothers and sisters, but then there's a family event at the same time. Drives me crazy. Don't make me choose, please. Somebody reschedule. Born to eternity, stranded in time. Born of the Spirit is what has to happen before we actually grasp that. But yes, there is a joy in the journey. So turn that page over. Okay, I guess we'll do another week, Jeff. So in the library is a chart. Now, if you haven't been privy to be in the library for any of our Bible studies, you don't know what that chart says. But in front of you is a replication of that. I tried to do one on my computer. I asked Caroline Brooks if she could help me, and she doesn't have her software that she used to have. And so finally, I just decided to do it with a ruler and a dark pen. So go ahead and take a minute. You got a pen. I want you to, at the bottom there, there's 8 numbers, and those numbers find a place corresponding to a letter in the grid. So take a minute and answer the ones that you know first. So don't sit there and labor over something. It's like, I don't know, where's that go? Do the ones you know and then come back and see if you can't plug in where the other ones go. Oh, you don't have... I don't see some people writing, so let's go through this. What number goes next to A2? Oh, look at me giving you the number. See, that's what happens when you get old. You give the answer. Yeah. All right. You got me on that one. Let's do, now this upper register is the original scheme of things, how history was supposed to evolve. The end of history, when the Messiah came, we go into the new creation, the new heavens, new earth, and it will go on forever. But then it changed. So what's B? What number goes with B?
5
is right. Ding, 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 ding. So what number goes with C?
2 again.
2 again, exactly right. What number goes with E? It's a hard one.
6?
Not 6.
1.
That's right. So 1 goes in there. How about, if you can turn it sideways, the letter I, what number goes there?
1.
Nope.
7.
Nope. The number 8 goes next to the letter I. So it's the future age and world fully realized in solid existence. That's the new heavens and new earth that we will realize. How about H? H7 is right. How about G?
Four
is right. How about F?
3
is right. And I think did we do D?
6.
Resurrection of Jesus. That's exactly right. So good job. The class passes. Nobody will be asked to stay after school and do, let's get these out. Yes. So worship is a topic, as I would tell Persephone or Heather or Paloma when she was little, subject is a topic that's this big. Worship. If you want some resources online, if you Google T. David Gordon, he's got all sorts of PDF stuff out there, but better yet, he's got lots of sermons and teaching sessions on worship. So I commend him to you. I listened to one of them this week. He's just so delightful to listen to. So smart, so witty. Okay. Well, the subject of worship has captivated me personally as an adult for my entire adult life, ever since I became reformed in my understanding of things. And I was reminded of that again last week in Jeff's sermon on John 21:14. This text that Jeff preached on last week gave us a kind of a peek behind the proverbial curtain of what life will be like in the new creation. Our Lord, in his resurrected body, walked along the beach of Galilee. He cooked for those blessed disciples breakfast. How fortunate were those guys? He ate and he drank with them, and no doubt he sat and enjoyed new creation fellowship and new creation conversation. The kind of stuff that goes on here every Lord's Day. In a moment of weakness, I was envious during that sermon of those guys. But then I remembered the Lord, that same Lord who was feeding them breakfast, is the same Lord who meets us on the Lord's Day. And he feeds us bread and wine. He preaches and speaks to us through Jeff. So we're not coming up short compared to those guys. So all that is to encourage us in our journey as we make the journey to the celestial city. And so what I've done today is I've chosen three scripture texts, and we'll get through whatever we can get through, but then what we can't, we'll pick up next week and we'll figure it out as we go. So let's read the first text that I want us to think about, and that's Micah 4. And I only remember this. Got an itch on my foot, excuse me. Jeff preached on this text. And I don't remember all the details, I just remember how it changed my thinking of worship. And then he preached again. There's a sister text in Isaiah 2, and Jeff preached on that as well. You can get those sermons and listen to them on your own on the website. So let's read this text. I'll go ahead and read it if that's okay. It shall come to pass in the latter days that the mountain of the house of the Lord shall be established as the highest of the mountains. It shall be lifted up above the hills, and peoples shall flow to it. And many nations shall come and say, "Come, let us go up to the mountain of the Lord, to the house of the God of Jacob, that he may teach us his ways, and that we may walk in his paths. For out of Zion shall go forth the law and the word of the Lord from Jerusalem. He shall judge between many peoples and shall decide disputes for strong nations far away. And they shall beat their swords into plowshares and their spears into pruning hooks. Nations shall not lift up sword against nation, neither shall they learn war anymore. But they shall sit every man under his vine and under his fig tree, and no one shall make them afraid. For the mouth of the Lord of hosts has spoken. For all the peoples walk, each in the name of its God, but we walk in the name of the Lord our God forever and ever." And so the imagery here, Micah, I'm going to abandon my notes and just ask you questions. What jumps out at you of this text in relation to worship? Jeff can't answer. I'll prime the pump. So the first thing that is clear is that the people of God, Israel, this is speaking to Israel, they're encouraged to go up this mountain. Zion is the mountain, and the people are encouraged to go up to the mountain. And what do they do at the top of the mountain? They meet with the Lord, that's right. Dwelling with their God, and they bring their worship to Him. Now, if you can go back to Genesis, the original Eden was a temple. And God met with Adam and Eve until they disobeyed and sinned. And when they did, God placed two cherubim at the entrance with flaming swords to keep them from returning to the temple place and eating from the tree of life. But Adam and Eve worshiped in the Garden of Eden. Those cherubim were then woven into the very fabric of the curtains of the tabernacle and into the Ark of the Covenant. Extraordinary care was taken within Israel when it came to meeting with God, right? I mean, extreme care. In fact, we'll see in a little bit that, well, I won't jump ahead. Extreme care. The Lord was very explicit in the Old Testament about how they were able to meet with Him, all right? When Israel ascended Zion to worship, only one single human representative could enter the holiest of all places, and that only once a year. One individual, a Levite, the high priest, could enter the Holy of Holies once a year. That person came from the tribe of the Levites. But the thing I want us to take away from this text is the image of ascending. Israel ascended. Do we ascend on the Lord's day? He comes down, but that's true. He does. He meets with us. But we go up. And we'll see that in Hebrews. We go up to meet Him. But we don't go to a physical mountain. We go to a spiritual mountain. We go into the heavenly sphere, the spiritual sphere, where the Lord Jesus is seated at God's right hand with all power and authority in heaven and earth. We go there to offer Him spiritual sacrifices, not sacrifices of animals and goats and things like that. So I'm getting a little ahead of myself, but that's the point I wanted to make, is the fact that when we come on the Lord's day, we, even though we're here and our feet are firmly planted on earth, we are ascending God's holy mountain. So if you have that image in your head every Lord's Day, that's a good thing to do. All right? So we're here, but look up, because that's where we are in Christ. So,
because true worshipers will worship in spirit and truth.
Yes,
it's not the physical.
That's right.
Mountain. It's a symbolic ascension.
It's a real ascension into a real reality that really exists with a real human seated at God's right hand, as we saw last week. And we enter into that heavenly, that dwelling place, and we bring our sacrifices of praise into His presence. Yes, Jeff.
I think it's essential to assume that the word spirit is an uppercase S.
That's right.
It's the Holy Spirit, not non-corporeal. It's the holy spiritual realm. It's the
yes.
realm of the Spirit.
The realm of the Spirit, exactly. And it's hard for us because we are physical beings and we're on the earth and our lives are tied into the physical material. But that's where the Word of Christ dwelling in us richly allows us to use our sanctified imaginations to wonder what that would be like. We get some glimpses in Revelation and some of the Old Testament prophets. But so anyway, when we come and you're driving in here to find a parking spot, or you're driving here or you're getting ready to ascend a holy mountain to meet with a holy God who Israel was so fearful of that they trembled. Moses himself, it says, trembled. And the people were full of fear. Touch that mountain, you'll die. That beast touches it, kill it.
They were prohibited from going up the
That's
mountain.
Right. That's
but
right.
Here, the people
That's
flowed
right.
up to the mountain.
That's right.
So something's happened.
Yeah, something's happened. We'll get there in the next text. In fact, let's go to the next text. I love this text. And I will tell you that I plagiarized a few things from T. David Gordon on this text. Now, there's so many texts that you could use to embellish and bring out some of the nuances of what worship is for the new covenant people. But so let's read this, 1 Peter 2, 1 through 12. So put away all malice and all deceit and hypocrisy and envy and all slander. Put it away. Like newborn infants, long for the pure spiritual milk, that by it you may grow up into salvation, if indeed you have tasted that the Lord is good. As you come to him, a living stone rejected by men, but in the sight of God chosen and precious, you yourselves, like living stones, are being built up as a spiritual house to be a holy priesthood, to offer up spiritual sacrifices acceptable to God through Christ Jesus. For it stands in Scripture, "Behold, I am laying in Zion a stone, a cornerstone, chosen and precious, and whoever believes in him will not be put to shame. So the honor is for you who believe, but for those who do not believe. The stone that the builders rejected has become the cornerstone, a stone of stumbling, a rock of offense. They stumble because they disobey the word, as they were destined to do. But you," and here Peter strings together, I counted nine descriptions of what Israel was called in the Old Covenant, and he assigns them to us, New Covenant temple worshipers, right? But you are a chosen race, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, a people for his own possession, that you may proclaim the excellence of him who called you out of the darkness into his marvelous light. Once you were not a people, but now you are God's people. Once you had not received mercy, but now you have received mercy. Beloved, I urge you as sojourners and exiles to abstain from the passions of the flesh, which wage war against your soul. Keep your conduct among the Gentiles honorable, so that when they speak against you as evildoers, they may see your good deeds and glorify God on the day of visitation. So as you look at that text, go ahead and rattle off the nine. Can you pick them out? I'll start it. We are what they were, a chosen race. Check. What else?
Living stones.
We are living stones. I don't have that in my nine.
A royal priesthood.
We are a royal priesthood. Just what else?
Holy nation.
A holy nation, and I wrote in parentheses a little editorial addition, without borders. So, you know, we're such a small group, but this group is replicated across the world, the globe. Every Lord's Day, there are groups like this who are assembling, ascending God's holy mountain to bring worship to the Lord Jesus. So a holy nation, that's us now.
And that should be understood in contrast to what we would otherwise be called the nations, or as Jews would say, the Gentiles, or as they would think of that term. The nation as opposed to the nations is distinguished throughout, especially the Old Testament.
Yeah. And the fact that we're a holy nation kind of also piggybacks on the Abrahamic covenant and a fulfillment of it. Every tribe, tongue, and nation, I mean, so where it's its own nation. Let me rattle off the others to save us some time. We are his own possession. We are people called out of darkness. People now called into his marvelous light. Once we were not a people, but now we are God's people. Once we were sojourners and exiles. Those are the nine that I have. That's what I got out of T. David. So if you have any issues with the nine, feel free to email David.
I was going to say this also ties in a little bit with the Micah verse, where we were once all different kinds of people, nations that warred against each other, hated each other, and now we beat our swords into plowshares, spears into pruning hooks. We don't lift up sword against each other anymore because we're we're no longer a separate people. We were not a people, now we are a people.
Good observation. I like that.
I find it interesting there that there still needs to be peacekeeping efforts in this time.
Mm-hmm.
Because he judges between many people and decides disputes for strong nations far away.
Mm-hmm.
And it's like, period, is this exactly, this is not after, is it in the already not yet, or is it in the not yet part, you know?
It's certainly in the not yet part.
So why would there be disputes in a not yet part that isn't
making It's already in the already part, yes, there are disputes for sure, right?
Yes.
There's disputes amongst people in churches. You see it all the time. There's divisions. That's why I have so many denominations. It's frustrating, yes.
But that sounds like that we're going to have peace on earth before Christ returns again. And it's like, it's not the way I understand it. It just gets more turmoil and more turmoil until finally we do ourselves in and or whatever. And
I think it starts first and foremost here in this present locality of the kingdom of God. We are the kingdom of God, the people of God. So there's no, we make sure that first of all, there's no disputes here. I can't have any control over what's going on in a company. If there's disputes, I was with my daughter the other day and she's disputing with some workers. And so there's frustration outside the kingdom of God in this expression of it locally. But here in this locality, there shouldn't be any, no disputes. The Lord will decide. He's given us elders and deacons to help us in that regard. So what's happened between Mike, what's happened, it's actually Hebrews, our next text. What's happened so that all these things were assigned to Israel have now been descriptive of us, the people of God, in the kingdom of God, in the new covenant. What has happened in redemptive history to cause this change? We're not afraid to go up the mountain. Anybody here fearful that when we ascend God's holy mountain, that God's going to strike us dead because of something we may have said or did? Anybody? No, we don't have that fear that they had. So what's changed? This is an easy one. This is a softball, guys. Yes, please. Yeah, Christ, a simple one word answer. That's right. The Lord Jesus Christ. Yeah, the stone of stumbling, the rock of offense. He's the one who's come and he's opened the way to give us access to our Lord and to the heavenly realm. And because of his work of forgiveness and sin of our sins, we then have access into the Holy of Holies in the heavenly temple. So verse 4 tells us that Christ is a living stone, which T. David pointed out in his magnanimous way, is a mixed metaphor. You don't have living stones, right? But Christ is a living stone. In God's estimation, he is chosen and precious, and we come to him. So on the Lord's day, when we ascend the mountain, enter his presence, we're coming to a living stone who is the Lord Jesus. Verse 5 has something to say about us. Because of our union with Christ, we are also made living stones. And as such, we are being built up into a spiritual house. And as living stones, we are now capable of functioning as priests to God. So no longer one Israelite going into the Holy of Holies once a year, but we go every Lord's Day freely. So please don't ever view worship as laborious, boring. Please, I hope you never ever feel that way. If that ever happens, then your heart, something's wrong in your heart. It needs to be fixed. Feel free to come to the elders and talk to them or the deacons. But it should never be that way. This should be the highlight of our week. And especially as we anticipate what God's going to say to us in worship through the ministry of the Word. And so we talk around here about that aspect of worship. We call it dialogical. And so Jeff greets us every Sunday What does he say? Say it out loud.
Grace and peace.
Louder.
Grace and peace.
Grace and peace. Is that Jeff giving us grace and peace? No, that's Jesus, the risen Christ in the unseen realm. Grace and peace to you. Wow. That should slay me right then and there, that what we're entering into is something really profound. So don't let it become so common and ordinary that you lose sight of the profoundness of that moment.
If worship is a struggle, I think it also is helpful to reframe it. It's helpful to reframe it. It's supposed to be rescued from.
Yes.
The world that beats on us every day.
Yeah.
What we're encountering on Sunday is just as real.
Yeah.
Even though it doesn't feel that way, it's is a reminder of that reality to come.
Right.
And hopefully can help us train, hopefully helps us train ourselves to think that way all week.
Yeah. Yeah.
There's a Sabbath rest that still awaits us.
Yes. Yes. We had some people once who attended here, and in the Reformed tradition, there's a group that hold to a strict Sabbath observance. So you don't do anything on Sundays, the Lord's Day, and I can appreciate that. We're a little bit different here, and so the strictness of the Lord's Day is really between the time of the call to worship, come, ascend my mountain, come, let me give you grace and peace, come. Between that time and when the Lord speaks to us in his benediction, that's the time we protect right there. Anything before and after? So we had some strict Sabbatarians visit and actually became members. And after some time, they said to us, you know what? Your people, your church, are actually better observers of the Sabbath than strict Sabbatarians, because we had a joy about it. I hope you look forward to the Lord's Day, especially the singing. Sometimes you'll see me up here, I may lose control of my emotions just because Kara might play Jesus, What a Friend of Sinners. I love that song, you know, because he's here as well as there, but he's here too, and we're going to see that in one of the hymns we sing today. He walks amongst the golden lamps. So when the Lord's here and we're passing the elements, is it Dr. Brooks and is it George and Bob? Or are we, we're giving you the elements, yes, but who's really giving you the bread and the wine? Jesus. So, what eye hath not seen and ear heard, what God has planned for those who love him. Is something I think about. What else? Anything else about? Yes, Rich.
I was thinking you said what has changed, and then you said what we enter into, and it's Christ. And when we think about all of the pictures that he has given us to show, he is the ark.
Yes.
The storm is raging outside. It's dangerous outside.
Yes.
And if we're in Christ, we're safe.
Yes.
If we're in that sheep pen, that's Christ, and we're safe.
Yes.
And amen. I'm inclined to think that Jesus is the Sabbath. Come to me, all you who are weary and heavy laden, mm-hmm. and I will give you rest. It's we're in him.
Yeah.
He is the Sabbath. He is Israel. He is the high priest. He is everything.
He is everything. Thank you. That's great. Yes, Karen.
Is it different from the minister's perspective? I mean, you're the one that's bringing to us.
Yes.
Nobody's preaching to you. Is it still a Sabbath day of rest for you?
Mm-hmm. But he's unique in that regard.
So then who provides that to you? Okay, got it.
Was there an answer there I didn't hear?
No, I think that was the answer.
Oh.
He couldn't think of anybody.
Well, let's do this again next week. I'll figure out which one we want to jump into, but we may continue with this because the whole Living Stones, we are the spiritual house. We are actually the temple too. So we'll go flesh a little bit more of that out of 1 Peter because it's rich you living stones. I hope you're boisterous this morning when we sing unto the Lord. All right, let's be dismissed and reconvene in 10 minutes.